contribution to the national life and to the church in its century of service is incalculable.
I had two goals in mind when I came here 100 years ago to form a boys' association. I wanted to instill obedience and discipline in the boys in my Sunday school who were just as badly behaved as others of their age. And I wanted to show boys that there was nothing effeminate about Christianity. 28 boys in their early teens, who considered themselves too grown up for the Sunday school, came here to meet me and two of my fellow Sunday school teachers. I hoped our Boys Brigade would prove popular. I must confess that even I was surprised that within 5 years, by 1888, I was full-time brigade secretary, and there were 230 companies, 800 officers, and 11,000 boys in Great Britain marching under the banner of Christ. A 100 years have gone by since that day, and we are still on the march. 370,000 boys around the world. Our methods of training may have changed with the times, but our aim is the same: the advancement of Christ's kingdom among boys.
I was a lieutenant in the 1st Lanark Rifle Volunteers. Many businessmen in Glasgow were members of the volunteer regiments, but we weren't training the boys to be soldiers. Those who charged us with militarism were confusing the end with the means. I wrote in 1885, "In proceeding to work out the idea of the Boys' Brigade, we came to the conclusion that nothing would be so attractive to a boy as some organization of a military nature, to teach him habits of obedience, reverence, discipline, and self-respect. Habits that would form the best foundation for a healthy Christian manhood."
There are no rifles in the drill now, and I was always aware that a rifle-drilled youth movement could prove attractive to the government and the War Office. And indeed, there was an attempt to bring us under War Office control.
Our movement was just 2 years old when the question arose of guns and their use. Mr. Goldstraw of Liverpool wrote to me in 1885 because he was thinking of forming a BB company, and he'd heard of another boys' organization in an English city who'd been given 500 carbines by the War Office. I replied, "We do use guns in our company, but they're not actual weapons. They are very neat models and cost about 4 shillings each. Some people have suggested getting arms from the government, but as the Boys Brigade is an essentially Christian organization, I do not think the government would recognize it. And even if it did, I question if it would be in the interest of the Boys Brigade to be under government control." And that question was to be answered. In 1907, the government put through a territorial forces bill under War Secretary Haldane. It offered financial support for youth organizations in return for overall control being given to the army. Although great pressure was put on us, we decided not to take part. The Church Lads Brigade in England, one of our affiliates, accepted. Then came the war. The original battalion of the Boys Brigade, the 1st Glasgow, formed the 16th Battalion Highland Light Infantry and went off to France. Nearly 600 of that 1,000 died in 2 days on the Somme. And after that war, feelings in the country ran high against militarism, and membership of the Church Lads Brigade in England declined. Our Boys' Brigade suffered a little, but by 1933, we'd more than recovered, and over 90,000 boys were wearing our uniform. That year was our jubilee, and at another football stadium here in Glasgow, Hampden Park, 135,000 people turned out to celebrate our 50th birthday. The Boys Brigade, which we planned and made, is trusted now to you. And we must heal the calm and to our craft be true. For 50 years the work's been done, and now we're proud to carry on.
For several hours beforehand, the streets were congested with boys and men accompanied by thousands of their friends, while tens of thousands of old boys marched in orderly columns from the center of the city. Hampden Park is the largest football arena in Great Britain, but it could not nearly accommodate all who wanted to attend this service. Long before the beginning, the gates had to be closed, and nearly as many again had to be turned away. The Glasgow transport officials say that the crowds on this occasion far exceeded the attendance at any international football match. Such a gathering was indeed a tribute to the high place which the Boys' Brigade holds in the hearts of the people of Glasgow. It was a happy idea that the boys of 1933 should send a greeting to their successors who will be celebrating the centenary of the brigade in 1983, and a massive bronze casket was prepared to contain this secret message. With solemn ceremonial, the message was signed by 6 boys and sealed by Dr. Greenlees in the presence of the entire camp.
My Lord President, it is with a sense of history that I invite you now to receive this casket on behalf of all the members of the Boys' Brigade, to break the seals thereon and to remove the message addressed by the boys of 1933 to their successors in centenary year. As this is the message which was addressed to boys, I think it is appropriate that the message should be read by another boy. Accordingly, I invite Sergeant Bruce Hannah of the 22nd
Paisley Company to come forward and read the message.
We, the boys of the Jubilee Session, send this greeting across the years to you boys who will be our successors. When we write this, you are as yet unborn, and we are celebrating the 50th birthday of the Boys Brigade in the year 1933. 34,000 officers and boys from all over the United Kingdom and from overseas have assembled in Glasgow, the birthplace of the movement to which we are all so proud to belong. We have recalled with pride the history of the past 50 years and have determined to do our best to ensure that the years ahead may also hold much of which you boys of the Centenary Session can be as justly proud. During these days of the Jubilee celebrations, the name of our founder, Sir William A. Smith, has been greatly honoured as the pioneer of organised work among boys. The guiding principles and the objects which he laid down have not been departed from in the last half century, and we face the future confident that our movement is built on a sure foundation. We, the boys of 1933, are enclosing this message together with copies of our Jubilee publications in this casket, which will thereafter be sealed and not opened until you boys open it in 1983. We greet you all and rejoice to think that the BB spirit, which is passed down from generation to generation, will reach you too through 50 years and link us all in the great comradeship of the Boys Brigade.
And although the world is a vastly different place from 50 years ago, many of our boys still meet in the same church halls they used then.
Classes, well, are quite good, but sometimes are not all that bad. I like the ones you can read, but I don't like the ones you have to write out and things like that. I don't like writing them.
Until we take off the wrapping paper and look inside, then we don't know what's inside a gift. When we're wearing our Boys Brigade uniforms, then it's pretty obvious that we're members of the Boys Brigade. But what about when we're not in...
As Boys Brigade officers, we're charged with helping these lads to set out on their Christian life as lads. And there are a great many pressures on boys that they weren't necessarily on the shoulders of the boys 100 years ago. We're faced with a harder job because we've got to try and get the message over in an age when it's really something which isn't talked about openly enough.
To meet people and make friends, and to take part in the sporting activities, the football and cross country, and to play the piano and the trombone in the battalion band. We were first in the battalion competition for the brass quartet.
I joined this company when I was 8 years old. I have been now 42 years in the brigade. The brigade is just as relevant now as ever it was, though poverty is not as it was when William Smith started the brigade, they have more attractions which can land them in bother, and we tend to develop with our principles of Christian activities and discipline, a very rare word these days. Activities we offer in this company, sport, bands, PE, badge work, expedition, we show that they have a relevance and that these principles of religion and discipline are vital. We're embarking now on new activities geared to the modern youth of today, and the brigade is very much alive to their needs and their changing needs. We are in fact fighting to keep them in the movement and to develop their lives and make them good citizens. I have seen that many youngsters who have gone off the straight and narrow have at the end of the day turned out to be good citizens, that what we taught them did in fact, when they came to the crunch, stand them in good stead.
And you know, many boys have grown to manhood from small companies like Mount Florida and become famous in their own fields.
It allows individuals to take themselves to the maximum, and it brings in a sort of fighting spirit between companies as well. So there is a lot to be got from the Boys Brigade in that sense. I competed for the Boys Brigade over the 8-9 years that I was in the Boys Brigade, and I had the fortune to win the Edinburgh Battalion Open Championships 3 times in a row, which has never been done before. It gives the individual an equal chance to put himself forward, you know.
My two brothers, Imrys and Ivor, joined the Boys Brigade with me in Tonopandy in the Rhondda Valley, 1923. We marched proudly through the streets. I couldn't play the bugle, but my brother could. And the sound of that music used to make my blood tingle.
The 58th Glasgow Company had a church hall near St. George's Cross, and that's where I started as a life boy, now known as the Junior Boys Brigade. And from there I graduated at the age of 12. And later, I left the 58th Glasgow and joined the 247th Company because I think it had a better band, and I was very fond of brass band music.
Well, I got into pipe band, and that's the nearest I've ever been to any kind of band. And I played in that successfully for the duration of my time in the Boys Brigade. I grew up listening to Irving Berlin and Cole Porter, and in fact, that's how I got this name, Bill Martin, because I met a guy and he says to me, 10 letters are very lucky in songwriting, because my real name's Wiley McPherson, William Wiley McPherson. And he says, Lionel Bart, 10 letters, Cole Porter, 10 letters, Lorenz Hart. I says, he's right. And it wasn't until I'd written Puppet on a String that I realized he forgot to tell me about George Gershwin, Burt Bacharach. So you could be talking to Wiley McPherson today.
I haven't actually got involved in too many organizations on a personal level, because I always feel it's so ridiculous to sort of split yourself around that you become valueless everywhere. But the organizations that I have got involved in have always been Christian. And for me, the Boys Brigade, having that kind of the whole outgoing thing about saying to young people, life can actually be full of fun, and yet there's a serious side to contend with. The Jesus factor is always there. For that kind of organization, I've always had a great soft spot, so therefore it was a great pleasure to become Honorary Vice President, because I know that the Boys Brigade presents Jesus in a lively, upfront, today sort of way.
Dougie Smith, that was one of the sons of the founder who ran the first Glasgow, he used to write a play every year. It was a kind of cops and robbers thing, and he shoved me in to play in the lead in that as soon as I got inside the door. And I did that for all the years I was with the BB, so I was in a sense quite an experienced actor by the time I left.
I don't think the other organizations had this sort of discipline about them, and I think this is what, at the end of the day, I think it does help everybody, and I think it was a great thing for me anyway. Yeah. I mean, let's face it, 8-9 years in the Boys Brigade with that sort of discipline, there's no doubt in my mind it made me a better individual for it.
The Boys Brigade itself is still quite a strength in the land. I was preaching recently down in the south of England, in Bournemouth, and I saw the Boys Brigade carrying the flags into the church with everyone standing as they come in. I see it from time to time in my own church, Wesley Church in Canton, Cardiff. And whenever the flag is carried in, you can see the pride in the boys.
It's a fallacy when they say that people don't like discipline. And part of the thing about being a Boys Brigade member is that there is this kind of element of discipline, this kind of, you're in groups, or you're in brigades, and you have to be with other people and obey. And I think that is attractive to a certain extent, to a great extent. But even more than that, I think probably the attraction to a young person is that they see Boys Brigaders having fun. I mean, they see people camping and just doing things that everyone else does, but only in a more lively, perhaps, fashion. And still with that emphasis that's always there, that all of this leads to one thing, and that's Jesus.
Came here 5.5 years ago to open it up as a centre within the Boys Brigade to give them an introduction to as many outdoor pursuits as we could. We can cover orienteering, archery, the assault course, canoeing and sailing, and during the winter we do some cross-country skiing as well. So the idea is to give them an idea of the sports, largely at an introductory level, but then take them on to more advanced things as they get a bit more proficient. Everybody pays to come here, but we work on the basis that we try and make the centre self-sufficient. And we're not really helped in any way, but we're not at the same time making any profit, so they're covering their own costs in coming. And we also go outside and do gorge walking, mountain climbing, rock climbing expeditions, that sort of thing, as well as the water sports. We've got quite a good team of helpers, apart from the permanent staff, and they've come from all sorts of different places.
Keep looking over your shoulder, a little bit to the left, that's it.
A lot of them are people who've been here on apprentice courses and things like that, or people who've come here to do their Duke of Edinburgh's residential course and enjoyed it and have said, could they come back again? Quite a lot of them are professional people, school teachers, youth and community workers. Quite a few are also Boys Brigade officers.
And others have joined the battle for young minds. 80 years ago, I invited a famous military hero, General Sir Robert Baden-Powell, to attend our display at the Royal Albert Hall. He was very impressed with the discipline and the high morale of our boys, and he suggested that if some form of scout training could be devised within the brigade, it would be good for the boys.
I knew the general had written a standard military handbook called Aids to Scouting, and I suggested that he might care to rewrite it as a handbook for the training of boys. In June 1906, I was able to report in the BB Gazette that the general had placed at our disposal the manuscript of a paper on scouting for boys, and that it would be of great help and interest, especially at our summer camps. Baden-Powell was very keen to try out his ideas for training boys in scouting. He organized an experimental camp at Brownsea Island in Dorset. We provided 10 BB boys, and 10 came from the public schools. It was a great success, and we organized meetings for Sir Robert to explain his ideas to the public. And Boys Brigade officers staffed his rallies. General Baden-Powell was a vice president of the BB and didn't want to start a separate organization. He suggested to us, to the YMCA, and to the Church Lads Brigade, that we teach our boys to scout. Indeed, BB companies included scouting in their work. But, inspired by what Baden-Powell had written, boys throughout the country were adopting his ideas, and the boy scout movement grew almost spontaneously.
December the 9th, 1909. Dear Sir William, I am forming an advisory council for the Boy Scout movement, owing to its now having attained a satisfactory footing throughout the empire. I am anxious to ask whether you would honor and help us by becoming a member of this council.
December 20th, 1909. Dear Sir Robert, I appreciate very highly the honor you do me in asking me to join this council. But after giving the matter very careful consideration, I am convinced that it would not be appropriate for me to do so, as I'm sure that being on the advisory council of the Boy Scouts, while brigade secretary of the Boys Brigade, would lead to much misconception.
Christmas Day, 1909. Dear Sir William, naturally, we all look to you as the leader of the boy movement. If you decide to help in directing the policy of the scout movement, the other heads will follow suit. And I believe that in so doing, you will be adding a very big step to the one which you first made for the good of the boys as a whole. The Prince of Wales is in favor of such amalgamation of aims, and would, I believe, become the president of such a council if formed.
December 28th. Dear Sir Robert, I have your kind letter of Christmas Day, and I do wish I could write differently from what I did on the 20th. This, however, I am afraid I cannot do. It seems to me that scouting is an excellent thing taken up within the Boys' Brigade or other organization. But when you take the Boy Scouts as a separate organization and propose to include all the others within an advisory council of the Boy Scouts, I fear that from both points of view, the thing would be unworkable. Let me say again how much I value and appreciate all that you have done for the interests of the Boys' Brigade and for the good of boys in general. This makes me feel all the deeper regret at having to disappoint you in this particular matter. Sir Robert's Boy Scout movement, I felt, would place less emphasis on religious instruction than our Boys' Brigade. But it certainly proved popular with boys. Even by our Jubilee year in 1933, Boy Scout membership outnumbered the Boys' Brigade in the United Kingdom by 3-1. Today, across the world, there are 370,000 members of our Boys' Brigade, mostly in countries where the Reformed churches are established. There are over 600,000 Boy Scouts in Britain alone. And Sir Robert's ideas are followed by 16 million boys around the world.
But I'm in good heart. The Boys Brigade is growing in countries like Finland, Denmark, Canada, Nigeria, Haiti, Jamaica, Bermuda, the Bahamas, and in the United States, where the Boy Scout movement is very strong. A Presbyterian minister called Dr. Chapin formed in 1900 what is now the biggest Boys Brigade company in the world, the Nina Menasha in Wisconsin.
As you look around this whole facility, you see dollar signs, you see money. This money, of course, hasn't been easy to get, but on the other hand, there are so many good people who have gone through it and have become successful in their professions that they're ready and willing to back others who are coming behind them with their money.
Why do you want to join a brigade? Well, because you think you'd have a good time in it, and because there are lots of other kids in it, and a lot of your friends are in it, huh?
We're financed in part from an endowment fund. The money's invested. We don't use the principal. We only use the interest, and we live within those means. And the building cost $1,200,000 in 1969 and 70 when we built it. We never had to sign a mortgage. The money was there when we needed it to pay the bills.
It's great to be in. And where do you live? Do you live in Nina or Menasha?
Load. Are we ready on the firing line? Commence firing.
Our rifle club is a part of the National Rifle Association. We're also part of the Department of Civilian Marksmanship, and this is a governmental organization that promotes civilian marksmanship. From that organization, by sending in statistics on firing, we get an issue of ammunition. We also are able to buy ammunition from the government at a reduced price. This makes the rifle club much, much more reasonable, much cheaper to run, so that any boy or girl who wants to join can.
Well, I have two brothers, and I love to compete with boys, and there was not many girls in rifle club, and I just thought, well, give it a try. And they had a girls' rifle program at the time. And so when I started shooting, I thought I had quite a bit of potential, and it just grew and grew, and I shot all I could and advanced into the co-ed program, and now I'm the top shooter at the brigade. Last year, I was ranked as the top 50 shooters in the United States, under 21. And I've thought of trying out for Olympics if I ever get that good. You know, I've got the potential, I think, my skills just need to be refined.
Okay, why don't you guys speed her up a little bit?
The building is tailor-made for the program. We were able to design a drill hall specifically for drilling. We were able to design a gym where the boys can play basketball and volleyball, and now they're playing soccer. We designed a rifle range that turned out to be one of the best in the States. The hobby club rooms are designed specifically for those hobby clubs. We have a dark room with 12 enlargers and stainless steel sinks and everything that the youngsters, the boys and the girls, need to learn about photography. We have a lapidary room where they can polish rocks and make jewelry. Just anything that a youngster desires. It's all built boy and girl proof. It's built out of things that are tough and strong. The boys and girls take good care of it. It's an ideal facility. We're very lucky.
I must say, I never envisaged a girls' organization being associated with my boys' brigade. Indeed, in 1887, I counseled Mr. Thomas Savage of Port Glasgow, who was forming a BB company there, that he must make it clear to his boys that there was no connection between the BB and the girls' class that he'd organized. From a boy's point of view, I said, you would take all the manliness out of it if you had girls going through the same exercises. But a townsman of mine, William Somerville, founded the Girls' Guildry in Glasgow in 1900, and clearly my fears were unfounded. By 1914, there were 165 companies. 15 years ago, the Guildry amalgamated with its Irish, English, and Welsh counterparts. And now, the Girls' Brigade has 170,000 members around the world.
I look happy.
Hey, well, I have my right hat on.
Years and years ago, the people who were the directors of the Boys Brigade found an island in a chain of lakes. It was a beautiful place, and they had the foresight to make the island available. They bought it. Over the years, many different groups have used it. Now, since the brigade is as big as it is, the island is used mostly by the brigade. There's a week of retarded children that come up here, and the local YMCA uses it for 1 week.
What? Sort of like enthusiasm.
Get off at a time, come through the front.
Camping has become a very important part where you can take a boy or a girl and have one solid week, 24 hours a day, of constant working with him or her to develop their character and their thinking about other people and their closeness to God, which is really what camping's all about. Oftentimes, a boy or girl who's having problems, if you put him or her in with a group of many others who are well-adjusted, the one who's having problems soon sees that you can have just as much fun being a good person as you can being a bad person. And many lives have been changed just on that principle alone.
Now, who are we going to try now? Clinger? Come on, Brett. Left-handed?
Just release it nice and easy.
Close, but you got the table.
Dennis, I said it's okay.
Money also is no problem in going to camp. Over the years, we've developed an endowment fund that people who have gone to and have enjoyed Onaway have given us money that has gone into an endowment fund. The earnings of this fund make it possible for us to take any boy or girl to camp, regardless of their financial status.
Okay.
When the Boys Brigade started, it was started in a Presbyterian church basement and pretty much limited to the Presbyterian kids. After we got a building of our own, a place where we could meet in 1928, then it was truly interdenominational because we weren't attached directly to a church. It made quite a difference then in the numbers of youngsters that we had because anybody could come. We stopped religious instruction as Bible study and left that up to the church of the parent's choice, but we still teach Christian principles. We teach appreciating God and appreciating the things he does for us.
Leaders of the companies will come forward, please.
In an organization where you have 900 or 800 kids, you're bound to come into some who do not believe in God and they don't go to church. In this case, we require that the parents send us a letter explaining this. We still, in spite of that, continue these Christian principles that we carry out.
Marching on. Glory, glory.
are affiliated to the Reformed churches. And our goal was and is the advancement of Christ's kingdom among boys, and now among girls. It may be that close affiliation with the Protestant church has limited our size. But as long as the church survives, so I believe will my Boys Brigade. And as long as the world wishes us to keep working to our goal, then we shall remain sure and steadfast.
Very kindly, person. Didn't give much away except to the boys. But slightly rigid, because he so firmly believed in drill and discipline that his army instincts came out. But that never smothered his natural love of boys.
We'd have probably the highest standard of all the youth organizations, and we insist on a very high standard. And a great many boys enjoy that challenge from start to finish. Most of these boys that were here today must have had 6 to 10 years of their regular weekly service at, say, 99% attendance, that kind of thing. And they want it, and they love it. And that is the discipline that they adore.
There'll always be young people, and they'll always be attracted to truth. And if organizations like the BB present the truth, which they do, the future's assured.
I believe that the Boys Brigade can attract, it's like a magnet, young fellows who want to make something of their life. And most youngsters do have their dreams and their ideals. As Longfellow said, I think the thoughts of youth are long, long thoughts. They want to do something with their life. And the Boys Brigade will go on into the 21st century, I believe, marching with pride and with the clarion call of the bugle.
As your patron, I'm delighted to be with you today to review the Boys Brigade in this, your centenary year. I congratulate you on this remarkable achievement, which has been made possible only by the dedication of generations of men and women whose faithful service and quiet example has led boys towards the Christian life. I remember being with my father at the Diamond Jubilee Parade at Windsor in 1943, when he said, "Your founder builded better than he knew, for he started not only a great movement, but one from which our present widespread youth training was destined to spring." There will be many who will come forward from your ranks to lead the brigade into its second century, and who, by their sure and steadfast service, will continue faithfully to advance Christ's kingdom among boys by giving them a spirit of adventure, a sense of satisfaction from physical activity, and a practical understanding of service to the community for their own and future generations.